We know that numerous efforts are underway to reduce that rate of physiological events in the F-18 fleet. Specifically, the Navy is modifying the software for the environmental control system, installing upgrades to deal with icing in some fluid lines, redesigning two pressure valves, developing a cabin monitoring system, and installing an upgraded emergency oxygen system. However, I think there are some other efforts underway that I wanted to ask about. Admiral Grossglags, what is the status of designing a new onboard oxygen generation system? How do you imagine the timeline for getting the first one fully tested, and what are the challenges?
There's two efforts going on right now that are related. The first is for the T-45, actually, and what we're calling that is a GGU-25. Excuse me. It's a replacement for the one they have now. It's largely intended as a reliability replacement with some improved performance, but it also provides a response to one of the key NASA recommendations was that we provide a oxygen concentration scheduling capability in our Navy aircraft, which we do not have in any of our tactical platforms today. That will take us partway to answering that NASA recommendation. The next step, which is a combined T-45 and F-18, is to get to a mil standard 3050. That's a very recent 2015 mil standard to get to a 3050 compliant oxygen generation system. That is something that we are going to compete between the two companies that are out there that do oxygen generators, because today there is not a system on the shelf that meets that new mil standard. So we want to see what both of them have to bring to the table. For the first effort, we believe we'll be able to start installing that in our aircraft late next year, and it'll be the following year, depending on what we get back from industry, it'll likely be the following year, so 2020, before we can get that new mil standard compliant oxygen generator.
Along those same lines, where is the Navy with the plan to install the cabin pressure and oxygen monitoring system, and when will that, similarly, what would the timeline be for that?
Right now, the timeline for getting that into our F-18s is the third quarter, so about a year from now, third quarter of 19. In the interim, what we are actually going to do is install in a limited number of aircraft the same monitoring system, the CRU-123, that we put in the T-45s. That's not a good long-term solution for the F-18s, but it will start to, again, provide us some information like we're getting from the T-45s that will hopefully get us to some of the root cause of what's going on in the aircraft.
And the Air Force F-16s have had an automatic ground collision avoidance system for many years. And we know it has had saved many lives. And in the past, the Navy has resisted efforts to install a similar system on the F-18. Where is the Navy on this issue today, given the track record that it's demonstrated in the Air Force?
I'll answer that. For the automatic recovery, for terrain avoidance is something that could be put in the airplane. Right now, it's not funded. From a physiological episode, that's not what it's designed to do. We have not had a controlled flight in terrain in the F-18E or F in its lifespan, but it's something that we will continue to reevaluate whether to put that capability in the aircraft.
Thank you. And then in previous briefings and hearings on this topic, we've been told that the Marine Corps fleet of relatively old F-18 aircraft are not experiencing the high rates of events that the Navy's older F-18s have. So, General Rutter, is that still the case? And if so, how do you explain it? Are there maintenance, operational, or reporting differences between the Navy and Marine Corps aircraft?
No, thank you, Congressman. We are tracking this right along with the Navy, and I believe, you know, if Clutch Joyner tells us to do something, we do it, and we jump and do it, and we're in step with the reporting procedures. This year, we have had only one in the F-18 and two in the Harrier. In years prior, most of our events have been pressurization issues in the older F-18, and we have reported and go through all the protocols that do that. I can't answer it exactly. I think if you look at the numbers, sometimes they get skewed with the training command and operational units and just where units are in the pipeline. But I assure you, whether it's a slapstick or Zorbent tube, whether it's the working through the simulators, We're right in step with the Navy and everything that has to do with PE. But I don't have a great answer for you. But this year, we're having another very low year with the F-18 so far, and I knock on wood, with just one F-18 event.
Well, that's good news, as long as it is the case that the reporting is essentially the same. I have another issue related to the F-35. Yesterday, there was a press report stating that DOD has stopped accepting deliveries of F-30 aircraft from Lockheed Martin due to a dispute over who will cover the cost of production errors in 2017 involving more than 200 aircraft. In the story, Lockheed Martin confirmed that deliveries have been suspended. So I have several questions about this report for General Bunch and General Grossglags. Is the report accurate? Is this report accurate?
So, ma'am, I will start, and I'll let Admiral Grossglags pick it up. It's a pause. I would not say it's a complete stop. There have been 14 block of the Lot 10 aircraft that have been delivered. There are a total of 5 aircraft that have not been accepted at this time. 3 of those are Air Force aircraft. 1 of those is from Norway, and 1 of those is from Australia. Those are aircraft that the program executive officer within his authorities has made that decision in coordination with Ms. Lord to make sure they knew what we were doing to address this quality issue. And we do not see it as a long-term problem. And if we have an operational need for the aircraft, we have discussed with Admiral Winter, and he's willing to entertain the idea that, and willing to work with us, that if we need the aircraft for an operational need, we will work with him to get those aircraft out of the hold that they're on right now.
And then what is the production defect in question? What is the issue here?
Ma'am, it goes back to a corrosion prevention in one of the holes that was drilled that was not corrected, properly treated, that was found during inspection at Hill Air Force Base. And we're now working through how that made it out of the factory and what we were doing to try to get that rectified in the fleet.
And why is there any question or dispute as to who is going to pay to fix it?
Ma'am, that's why I am letting Admiral Winter work that with the company, and he is carrying our water in that area.
Admiral Grosslegs. So, yes, the report is accurate. We know it's the defect. Anything you want to add?
Let me add, I agree with everything General Bunch said. We know what the technical solution is. This is purely about who's responsible for the cost. And I agree with Admiral Winter's decision at this point in suspending delivery of those aircraft. Quite honestly, this was a mistake made by the contractor during production, and they should pay for that out of their bottom line, not our top line.
Thank you both, and I yield back.
Our questioners next are Cook, Gallego, and McSally. Mr. Cook.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. This morning, we had General Mattis there, and I asked him some questions about the F-35, and it's kind of in line with what we're talking about.